We were swept up with this amazing pub scene that was all the rage in the late 70s and early 80s. And you do it as long as hard as possibly you can, because if you don't, there's someone else that'll do it better.
Rob Hirst dreamt of being a rock star way back when he was knee-high to a drum kit.
What did that look like?
It looked like a pair of drumsticks given to me by my folks on my 7th birthday.
What sane parent would give their child a set of drumsticks?
Crazy. What were they thinking?
Rob's love for drumming only grew, and in high school he formed a rock band with some mates.
We decided we need a real lead singer, so I put an ad in the Sydney Morning Herald. A couple of people turned up, including Pete Garrett.
And was it obvious that he was going to be the one as soon as he got behind the microphone?
Well, it was obvious that he had something completely original, special. He may not have had the best voice on the day. That's true.
That'll get back.
It already has.
Midnight Oil went on to become one of Australia's most successful music acts of all time. But just as the band was taking off, Rob's life hit a crossroads.
You're 17 years of age and you discover that your then-girlfriend is pregnant. What was that moment like?
So that gave me pause. The idea of taking on responsibility when I was just about to go to uni and I had this band or bands, looking after a tiny child wasn't really part of the plan at all.
Did you consider keeping the baby as a couple?
No. Yeah, it was very brutal, Lisa, back then. Usually the young teenage mother was whisked away interstate for a holiday somewhere, and then the child was given up for adoption almost immediately. Sometimes all the names were changed to protect the guilty. So we weren't told the sex of the child. They just said, you kids get on with your life. You'll never find this child.
That child was Jay O'Shea.
I was the adopted child that my mother always wanted. You know, you're special because we chose you when we brought you home from the hospital. And so much so, apparently, I was in Coles one day with my mum and somebody yelled out, special on tomatoes. And apparently I yelled out, I'm special, me, I'm special, as a, like a young child. So I think they handled it really beautifully.
Music was a huge part of Jay's childhood, something that set her apart from her adoptive family.
I just knew from a very young age that I could sing. It was just a passion from I could remember.
17 when she had a kid.
Anybody else in the family a singer?
No, no, not in the family that I grew up with, no.
And then in your early 20s, you decided that you wanted to track down your birth parents.
I wanted to know if there was anybody out there that looked like me, who could sing, who might be musical. And it just felt like a book that I could never read the end of. People were kind of really nice on the phone. Sure, absolutely, I'll look that up for you. And then I hit brick wall after brick wall after brick wall. And this went on for a good 6 or 7 years.
Jay switched focus to her music career, moving to Nashville and forming the country music duo O'Shea with her husband Mark. Then in 2010, Jay received the news she'd waited 35 years for.
There was an email saying, your birth mother has made contact, how would you like me to proceed? And I remember bolting upright in bed, and just bawling my eyes out. And just knowing that it was real, I just felt it, I knew it was real.
So how long did it take you to ask who is my father?
She basically told me my story.
What was your reaction?
I think I just laughed to begin with. I just went, oh yeah, of course, that makes total sense. Crazy story. My husband and I are friends with Bones Hillman, the bass player from Midnight Oil. And so when we got that news, Bones and his wife were due to come around for dinner, and my husband and I just looked at each other and just went, how on earth are we going to tell Bones that his best friend and drummer of the band that he's been in for like years is my father? It's like the Bold and the Beautiful. It's like this weird. We told them, and just at that time, the phone rang, and it was Rob. And I remember just feeling like my hand started to shake, and I grabbed the phone out of his hand, and I felt like just a little girl, and hello, you know, and he said, hi, doll, how you going?
A few months later, Rob and Jay met up for the first time.
There were so many years and so many things to talk about. Of course, I had to tell Jay about my daughters, Lex and Gabriella, and she wanted to know about their lives.
They were wonderful, you know, and they very easily couldn't have been, you know, particularly Rob's wife, Leslie, just absolutely welcomed me in.
When did you first tell Leslie that there was a child out there somewhere?
When the letter arrived in the letterbox.
So she had no idea that you had fathered another child?
No, something I'd just forgotten to talk about for 36 years.
That was a very big secret. Did you ever feel bad about keeping that?
I think it was part of the whole, about a part of your life that you are, you know, you've... would likely to be painful if you resurrected that. So I guess it was kind of a self-defense in a way, but I definitely should have mentioned it before that day.
Watch us waving goodbye, good love.
So what has it meant for you, meeting Jay?
I have two little girls, so it's Gramps and Lily.
I'm a grandfather to the girls, and that's been joyful. Then the other side, of course, is this musical companionship that we have as well.
In the countryside.
Now, after months in the recording studio, the father-daughter duo are preparing to release their first album together.
It's a musical conclusion from everything that's gone before.
It's a fairy tale ending.
Amazing story, and Rob and Jay's incredible album, The Lost and the Found, will be released a little bit later this month. For more details, just jump on our website.